This video took so long, man. I mean, we're talking over a terabyte in file size. We're talking over 100 hours of editing, writing, the whole nine yards, and this still won't be my longest raid video. But yes, everybody, it is finally here. Deep Stone Crypt. Thank you guys for the wait. And man, if you guys are new here, not new here, and you're not subscribed at this point, I think it might be time. Thank you guys, and enjoy the video. 1 year, 1 month, and 16 days. 1 year, 1 month, and 16 days. That is how long it has been since the last raid Bungie has made. This is the longest we have ever had to wait for a raid in Destiny history, and for good reason. Deep Stone Crypt may be the most unique and next-gen a raid has ever been in Destiny. Well, ever. In today's video, we cover the events leading up to the raid, the day one raid race, the aftermath of the raid, and much, much more. So without further ado, let's just get right into it. Hey guys, just wanted to let you know, you guys absolutely crushed it on the See You Soon merch, and we are getting a new merch design inspired by this raid done in the near future. But for now, if you would like to check out some merch, my wonderful friend and clanmate Frosty is great at making merch, and he made some really cool looking designs. So if you want to check those out, link is in the description, man. In these videos, I like to give you context as to why stakes are high, emotions higher, and challenge a true pinnacle. This is the raid Deep Stone Crypt, released on November 21st of 2020, at 10 a.m. Pacific, 1 p.m. Eastern. Take into account, Beyond Light dropped a whole 11 days prior to this raid, and for somewhat good reason. The goal was to hit Contest, which put players at 20 levels under each encounter, and you were meant to reach power level 1230 by raid day. Players started the DLC at power level 1060 with the soft cap of powerful, so any drop at all, scaling up to 1200. After 1200, powerful drops were the only way up. Many players competing knew this system in and out, and the only difference this time around was that no plus zero gear drops could be given through token farming at vendors like in previous DLCs. This time, however, powerful plus one drops could be given through any source in the game just by simply playing, a system we haven't seen since the Taken King. The leveling system was actually very fast if you played comp, since powerfuls would drop almost every game and has been like this since Forsaken. The other new caveats to this DLC were armor mods from Shadowkeep now not being associated with affinities, with a few exceptions. Add in weapon sunsetting, so no more mountaintop recluse, and you had players adjusting to using new weapons for the first time since the middle of Forsaken 2 years ago. Stasis was also introduced, and many players thought that stasis was going to be used in the raid by the bosses, but that didn't happen. Warmind cells in charge with light mods definitely did have an impact on day one, however. The final thing I would add here is the weapon and class meta going into the raid. This is early in, but for now, the consensus is the Lament and Slug shotguns, but on day one, it was slightly different. On day one, swords were still used, but things like Izanagi's Burden, a sniper rifle found from Black Armory, and other snipers from previous seasons that weren't sunset were going to be used here. This is the first time in a raid, of course, that sunsetting played a big role. The consensus from the community was that this raid had to be tremendous, especially after Garden of Salvation had some mixed views from the community as a whole. Now, I know I haven't made the Garden of Salvation video yet, and that one is coming soon, but just pretend like the order is flipped on them for now, for this video. Coming off of a seriously rough year for the Destiny community, Beyond Light had some really high expectations, and this being paired with next-gen consoles arriving at the same time led to the expectations of this DLC shooting through the roof. If Bungie has a reputation for something in Destiny, it's throwing a Hail Mary and saving the game from going down a bad path when absolutely needed. So, Beyond Light released, and it was split with thoughts. So many people had an issue with paying $40 for the DLC, and so many were not satisfied with the loot on day one, while the other half were excited to hop into some fresh new content on Europa. Bungie uses a method to content called drip feed. This means that week to week, we get a drip of content to feed ourselves. There's good and bad here. The good is that if the content warrants this method, and it's a great week of content, then players feel treated well. It's there to service a potential massive content drought that Destiny 1 had with the Taken King and Rise of Iron. Now the problem with drip feed is that if the feed isn't great, then the drip is not enough for that week. The reason I went through the explanation of that is because that was the reason most players went one of two ways, but nothing is final on a DLC until the raid comes out. The raid is, in my opinion, usually the make it or break it moment on thoughts for a DLC. Forsaken is praised for being an amazing DLC in every way, but would Forsaken have been the same if Last Wish was not as crazy of an experience? I'll leave that to you to decide in the comments. Anyways, 11 days after the DLC, over 2 million players logged on to Destiny 2, with over 1.6 million players attempting the long sought after Deep Stone Crypt raid. The birthplace of Exos and one of the most talked about but never seen places in Destiny history. Places where characters were born, like Cade 6, Ada 1, Banshee, we'll get to him later, 44, and of course, the Exo Stranger. So, now that that is all out of the way, let's see how day one went down.
We're going in, boys.
Let's go, boys!
Here, middle.
What is going on?
You better be dead this time, Kerr.
Let's go.
That's it!
Welcome to the Deep Stone Crypt, a raid with contest modifier on to keep players 20 levels under each encounter. This one would start in a place familiar to players, the Eventide Ruins, and this did the Destiny classic that I love, where the raid is naturally a part of the world in-game. Some players would notice earlier in the week that these normally arc-shielded captains were actually void captains, and that this bunker door had to be important in some way. On day one, I figured this door would take us straight to the underground crypt, and oh boy, was I so wrong. Not only was this door not taking us to the crypt, we had to step into the decontamination room like something out of Bioshock to enter the next area. This area is what I will just call the storm. Bubbles for sheltered from the storm buff, sparrows to go forward, and almost no sight for you and your teammates. Remember when I said in the first impressions video that I wanted the storm on Europa to factor in more than just pushing my sparrow? Yeah, this is what I meant. Only lights barely visible were your guidance, and it was easy to fall off and get lost in the storm. If you were frostbitten to times 10, you would also die. So on day one for those racing, this actually had an impact since it was extremely close the whole way through this area and some upcoming areas. Teams would finish this encounter at the two brigs near the end in around 10 to 20 minutes on average, but they definitely would miss the chest to the right. This encounter reminds me a lot of the opening to Crota combined with the Scourge of the Past Sparrow section. It's honestly very, very good, and once through the icy tundra, it was actually time to enter the crypt. Welcome to the Deep Stone Crypt, the birthplace of Exos, the place long spoken about, and one of the cleanest, most appealing aesthetic places ever in a video game. Racers were concerned with finding the right path as soon as possible, and when reaching the room, the only thing known to them was a red symbol of a person. This buff is one that you're going to have to get familiar with, known as Operator. And the fast way to explain this is that there's three consoles to pass this buff through. One on the light side of the room, one on the dark, and one down below. This buff had to be picked up to start the encounter, and players would soon find out that this was a bit more complex than your ordinary raid encounter. For those unaware, This encounter almost works like leading a blind person through. One player grabs the operator or red buff and goes underneath to find 4 out of the 10 total panels to shoot. If they fail to shoot the correct 4, or if they run out of time, they burn to death. The person leading them through looks through the glass on the floor to see the correct panels. Problem is that one side is cut off from the other, so you need to pass the scanner to the other side for them to read as well. After all 4 panels are shot, it's time to do damage to the fuses of the crypt. You need it to toss scanner down there and operator up top. This will allow the player at the bottom to read which fuses to shoot for the other 5 up top. On day 1, this actually lost a lot of teams a ton of time since taking too long caused a wipe. Shooting the wrong one on DPS caused a wipe, and generally figuring out these mechanics took a pretty long time too. After anywhere between 40 minutes to 2 hours, teams beat this encounter and raced through. One thing you can note here is teams not caring about the loot a ton and just zooming through. Remember, this is a race to world's first, not for god rules on weapons and armor, so that can always come later. Once through, some revelations were discovered and our first real boss fight was on its way.
More door this way.
There's a guy. Right, cave, dude? There's a dude right there. Watch.
Oh. Hey, man.
Is this the bat cave?
Right here?
It's a boss. It's kind of creepy.
You may be confused by this statue, and you wouldn't be alone. More on that statue later into the video, but for now, racers were hit with an amazing intro to the encounter.
Oh my god, that boss looks
sick.
It's
Tenex.
Oh, he's coming.
Oh, is this the exorcist? What the f***?
Atraks 1. Tanix being freed by the fallen that Eramis told to prepare the body.
Atraks. Critis and I can handle this. Return to the crypt and prepare the body.
Tanix, who also showed up in one of the Eramis cutscenes, didn't seem like Tanix so far though. He may have looked the same, but man oh man, Tanix was pissed, punching the glass and crawling up the ceiling like some sort of spider. Atraks, however, one of the coolest, if not the coolest raid boss I have ever seen in Destiny, was on the plate for this one. Fun fact, the Mask of Bakris, the exotic hunter helmet, is Atrax's face. Yeah, that lore is creepy as hell, but let's talk about the fight, because dude, when I say this is how you do a boss fight, I mean it.
Atraks one. Oh, okay, that's how you start the encounter. Good to know.
Let me know.
Just look for things.
So we
can actually make it to the
extinction protocol activated.
Do we have any idea where any of the buffs are, like scanner, operator,
I'm
anything?
Looking.
Bye! There's pods. I'm going to space! I'm in space!
What?
In space. I'm in space!
Oh my god!
Where is T-Rex?
I told you I'm in space! How is this not clear?
Yeah. We left Europa for this one. Excuse, we're leaving Europa? Wait, no, we're not. Wait, are we? Wait, we left Europa. We left Europa. In one of the biggest raid plot twists, we shot into outer space and onto a space station. Day one raiders couldn't even keep their cool here. It was that special of a moment and took me right back to the Halo days of Bungie, with a boss fight that was either your most hated on day one or your favorite on day one. Which one was this fight for you? For me, this is my favorite encounter on day one, with mechanics to fit the special feeling. So, if the last encounter was like leading a blind person place to place, this was like having a traffic guard directing players through, with 2 others being constant eyes for the team to do damage. 3 players went to space, and three players stood down low. All six players were responsible for one servitor, and on the space side, one ad held scanner buff for someone to be the eyes in space. Now, you may have also noticed that there is a bunch of Atraxes. Actually, Bungie made the ultimate dad joke and put 8 Atraxes. Not joking, just a really bad joke. Once both sides have killed their servitors and the scanner has been grabbed, damage starts up top and the eyes of the team calls out the right one to hit for a small amount of damage. Scanner must then be passed down to bottom and operator must be passed up top. Atraks will drop a replication of himself on the ground for someone to pick up. At the time, many teams went through this thinking the buff had something to do with damage or starting a damage phase and didn't think that the stun mechanic was the damage phase. Matter of fact, this whole fight is one long damage phase, almost reminiscent of Riven if you did that the intended way. On day one, not only did the health almost not move on Atraks, but it regened, which is intended and not intended. Let me explain. In Destiny 2, there is a bug that if you pump out too much damage too quickly, it causes a boss to heal. A lot of hardcore players know this one all too well, but I would say most players were exposed to this on day one, and I hope that this is the reason it gets fixed, because man, is it annoying. But it's more of a server-side bug, so I don't know how fast it'll get patched. Either way, the boss's healing is also intentional, but only a tiny bit. So we all thought we were missing something here and needed to do something else. Was it going to be damage with the replication on a player? Was it going to be to use operator and bank all three into the same door? Was it three separate doors? Nope. None of them. The order of operations were damage, pass scanner down to the bottom and operator up top, keep operator up top and shoot the buff into space off a player that picks it up. Just don't let that person be the operator, or if it is, use ricochet rounds and shoot it off your own head. Someone from down low picks it up and comes to the top to be cleansed, and it's a rinse and repeat. This is an absolute endurance fight, and I would say this was the big check for day one teams racing, as stories of my team spent 12 hours at Atraks but didn't beat it came out all over the place. Yeah, this fight was not easy on day one, not even close to it. This took top teams racing over 2 hours, and while yes, it has to do with not understanding the mechanics, it was also because of the longevity of the fight and final stand.
Left, the one from last time, at the very end, left, close.
Dude, where are they? Oh, bottom right, all the way under here.
Scanner.
Dude, this one right here, who cares? Let's do it.
It's this one.
That was right.
No.
Hold on. Underneath.
Middle.
Why? We had plenty of time, dude. We definitely did. Yeah, it may seem like I'm being a dick to my teammate on a run that was a wipe at final stand, but trust me, that's just day one competitive race talking. And let's be real, that was pretty funny. Yeah, final stand. All 8 Atraxes went to the top and operator had to keep buff off their teammate while you found the correct one multiple times, while still dealing damage with the health bug of Atraks. Absolute chaos, but damn man, I love this encounter.
Do you have your server?
I killed my server.
Wer hat den Scanner gerade?
Nur die, oder?
Ich hab den Scanner. Du musst erst wegschießen.
So unique in Destiny. Shooting off into space, the little details like the airlocks actually vacuuming the buffs into space, everything was just fantastic in my opinion. One team was in the lead here, to my knowledge. A German team that placed 4th in Garden of Salvation's world's first race was about 20 to 40 minutes ahead of everyone else. Where most teams in the lead were done with Atraks in around 3 hours and 40 minutes into the raid, this team was done in about 3 hours. So that was Atraks 1, a chaotic and stressful endurance boxing match of a fight and one that I don't think I will ever forget about on the day one experience alone. Our next area was not Atraks Chaos at all. Actually, this was the rest that players needed, and I'll just shut up for this one and let you listen for yourself. Deep Stone Lullaby, man. One of, if not the best songs Destiny has ever produced in the perfect setting for it. With a voice breaking down that the Deep Stone Crypt is also the so-called Fountain of Youth, or the Fontaine du Chavance, I think that's how you say it, please French community, do not roast me, to Clovis Bray, and that we aren't welcomed into the space station.
Enjoying yourselves, intruders? It's worth knowing the cataclysmic damage.
That we will face godlike judgment, and that it will be extended eternally.
You now face godlike judgment. May it extend eternally.
I want to stress how great of an experience this area is, especially that first time. Not knowing where to go in space, just having that downtime before your next encounter. Almost like the fountains in Black Garden for the Garden of Salvation after Harpy encounter. There's a chest and more audio logs, but teams on day one were going as fast as possible finding the route. Once the sights were taken in, the next encounter was absolute insanity. To my knowledge, not only was Ethereal Clan ahead, but the next closest team would be Slayerage and Ascend Team 2, still decently far behind, with the other 7 teams in the final race catching up to them, were still all dealing with Atraks. Ethereal zoomed through these hallways, missed another audio log, and just flew straight into the chaos that was the Rapture.
Be a second. All
right, it's close right and left. Close right and left.
This encounter can only be described as a perfect non-boss encounter to me. You still have the scanner from the previous fights, the operator too, but this time, a blue buff called Suppressor was on the field. Oh, and after a beep, bombs started to spawn. The goal here was simple. Use your eyes to know where the bombs can be dunked, use the operator to shoot a panel that stops an extra bomb from spawning, and use Suppressor to stand underneath these beach balls and shoot Tanix to stun him, opening the deposit stations to be dunked. Do this 6 times, and that's about it. The real issue on day one was after every time neutralizing the reactors, one person had to lose their buff and swap it to a teammate. So organizing this was not only a bit of a struggle, but learning a new role on the fly was going to prove difficult. I would say this encounter served as more of a set piece encounter, especially if you were watching the background at all, but some teams thought this meant they were wiping, while other teams pieced together that that was intended what was going on. And with the next 2 closest teams in the race, Ascend, the clan that won Garden of Salvation's World's First featuring Slayerage, and Luminous, a team of very good speedrunners and challenge players, not even done with Atraks yet, this was all but free real estate to advance for Ethereal. Now, for you to prevent Europa from blowing up entirely.
Okay.
Okay.
Pay attention. Pay attention.
Coming right
here.
Let's go.
Oh,
we just fell to the ground?
Yes, you're gonna have to book it somewhere. Yeah, book
it. In the middle.
Down
go
there.
Down. Go down in the middle.
Just fell down.
We did it. Go.
Go.
Oh, shit. Whoa.
It's still darkness. Run.
I'm running. Was ist abgegeben?
Muss ich.
Lass clear now.
I love this encounter. It's chaotic, makes great use of the new mechanics introduced to the raid, and has some serious story significance, as you just found out. It's not just the story either, it's the small details too, like the blast shields coming over the windows, then being blown off, and the ship actually moving closer to Europa in the process. It's the touch of Clovis calling us a little rat.
Clever little rat.
That's messed up. And saying we left the crypt defenseless, so now anything can go there, making me think that something else will go on there. The hallway's blowing up as the music hits the apex, and the screen glowing white as the whole space station crashes down onto Europa. Story-wise, Team Ethereal was the first to the wreck, but definitely wasn't the last. In the brief window that Ethereal finished this encounter, other teams had passed Atraks and were on the previous encounter, only one or two steps away.
Wait, oh, he's behind me.
Spawn?
Toby, he's running. Run!
Still darkness?
Uh-oh. I'm putting down a rift.
We're going somewhere.
What's happening? Thank you for the well, dude.
What is happening?
Dude, I am Monk having a seizure.
I assume we just crashed.
We just hit the ground, dude. Oh my god, this raid is insane, Bungie.
Oh my god, dude. This is amazing.
Yo. We're in the snowstorm that we started in. If you haven't noticed, though, we are now in the same place that the raid started. The entrance of the Deep Stone Crypt. But this time, it's different. Debris everywhere. Pieces of the orbital station now make up the arena and the background set pieces. Only a piece of rubble was in Ethereal's way, and this piece just did not go down easy. Meet Tanix, the Abomination.
Alright, here we go.
Oh, there's something red there.
Alright, well. Tanix, as Varric says,
Tanix has no house. He kneels before no banner, owes allegiance to no Kel. He is a murderer, and very good at what he does.
Number one rival to Eramis, and the only Fallen that is more machine than Fallen, has become an absolute abomination by flying in on Saber 2 from Destiny 1. Team Ethereal would reach this point in less than 4 hours, and was on real great pace to take Worlds first. If Atraks was an endurance fight, Tanix was in direct contrast as a damage check for contest mode. The time is now 2 p.m. Pacific, 5 p.m. Eastern, and only two teams are really neck and neck with each other. Ascend Team 2, featuring Slayeridge, and Ethereal were neck and neck, with Ethereal reaching Tanix first. Both teams would seriously struggle here and allow a massive window of opportunity to catch up because of multiple factors. Like I said, Tanix was a tank, literally and figuratively. Running Divinity was not only going to be a huge help here, but massively important to deal with Tanix. Side note, I don't know why Tanix is on a big shank, even though there was literally no big shanks in the entire raid. I don't know, maybe he found one in storage or something. 9 teams made it to the final boss and were fighting neck and neck at the end because DPS kept causing wipes for the teams that were ahead. Some, but I'm not sure all of the teams which caught up were Luminous, Tier 1, Garrison, Last Rites, my clan, obtained Team 1, and Math Class, with some folks that weren't streaming their POV as well in that top 10. Let me break down Tanix's fight really quickly on day 1. Tanix required teams to break up into pairs of 2, with one team having the scanner buff on their side, one with operator, and one with suppressor. Scanner would look for the deposit stations like the last encounter, but this time there were 6 instead of 4, and they were spread out. After clearing tanky captains and some vandals, grabbing the buffs on each side, Tanix would go to one of the sides and start a vulnerability phase where you could shoot a couple of his pods, which in turn dropped the nukes from the previous encounter too. Once 2 nukes were grabbed, the operator had to break you from the detainment bubble, while the suppressor waited for the second detainment before stunning Tanix. Dunk the balls in the stations and scanner called out, then do it again to go to DPS. DPS was odd. Jumping through debris and not trying to get hit. Roast Tanix. Lots of teams lost here because of a couple of reasons. Not only was Tanix one of the tankiest bosses ever made, and Divinity was necessary, actually so necessary, but teams didn't really use Divinity as much as they could have and suffered as a result. Divinity works by creating a crit spot on the boss's hitbox, but for most bosses in the game, it does not trap their actual crit spot. So instead, Divinity applies the debuff to the boss's body, but not headshot. So for example, if you shoot the Divinity bubble on a boss's body that is trapped, but not their actual crit spot, 99.9% of bosses will actually be hit harder by shooting their head, making the Divinity bubble less optimal to even be shooting, thus maybe requiring something like Tractor Cannon where you can shoot it, apply the debuff, and have everybody shooting the head. Tanix did not work like this though, and the bubble worked by going underneath his body and still doing as much as a headshot. My clan obtained team 1, finished lower than they may have here because of this. They made a quick swap over to Tractor Cannon and that cost them a ton of spots, but just something interesting to know with Divinity.
Bubble's underneath him.
It's immune.
My bubble's gone. Get back in. God damn it, I died to debris.
Yeah, div bubble's right underneath him, peeps. Don't shoot at him, shoot at the div bubble.
No, don't shoot the div bubble.
The div bubble is immune.
No, shoot him. The debuff is back.
Another Divinity bug also happens, and that has to do with the Charge with Light mod, High Energy Fire. Some teams ran this mod for 15% extra damage for general ad clear, but for some reason on Tanix, anyone in your fire team who runs this mod will cause the Divinity bubble to hit for about 20k less per shot. The reason I bring all of that up is because Tanix was the DPS check for teams. So missing out because of Divinity and High Energy Fire antics actually had a bigger role in deciding day one than you would typically think. Back to the fight, however. Most teams decided to run Izanagi's Burden with a grenade launcher heavy because of quick draw hot swapping. This is when you sprint while also hot swapping weapons and time your Izzy reload with your grenade launcher to allow the game to catch up to it. If that made no sense, just watch how much faster you can pump out damage this way. Unfortunately, or unless you had hunters with Celestial Nighthawk, you were still, after 3 damage phases, probably not going to have enough damage for one last thing. Final Stand.
Go, go, go! Damage! In the middle! Damage! In the middle! I got Divinity!
With so many of these teams getting there and failing due to DPS, Tanix teleports to sides of the room with the goal to wipe your team after only a few teleports. Most teams didn't have the ammo ready to go for this phase and wiped accordingly.
Are you kidding?
Ammo, bro. I don't have ammo.
So close, man.
One team, however, thought ahead of this. When I asked them after the fact, they told me that, quote, "We heard that damage was really tight, and instead of looking at other teams and seeing what they were doing, we went straight into what we knew in terms of damage and did a quick run to test a few different weapons before deciding on double snipers. After we realized that we can use Divinity with double snipers for better DPS, I was pretty sure we had an advantage over the other competing teams. Our mentality was, we gotta bake this dude, whereas other groups tried to be rather conservative with their heavy ammo. The winning team went into this with double snipers and falling guillotine as their heavy to deal with captains and general ad clear. You need to sacrifice one or two of your team's supers to make special finishers too, so you had enough ammo for final stand. With the race neck and neck and teams getting 20 minutes per run just to get to final stand and wipe, one team had the stars align.
Nice one, man.
Get ready.
Where are the ads? Go over to the left.
Right here. Okay, he's up.
I can do two.
I missed you.
Two. Heal rift. Bubble. Crazy.
Middle.
Bubble. Watch out for that. Close the shit. Left. Range one.
Okay, get it on him. Just DPS.
Div crit, DPS, fucking DPS.
Q.
Kill him, kill him, kill him.
Kill him, kill him, kill him, kill him.
Now, we can do it, we can do it, we can do it, we can do it.
Where?
He's
left, 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 left.
Yes!
Let's fucking go, please!
Oh my god.
Chill, chill.
Really proud of you guys. That's alright.
Chill,
don't. Did you get the chest? Oh, we did, okay.
No, oh, there's a chest.
We don't have mission complete, do we?
Get mission,
get mission, okay, okay, sorry, I'm sorry, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. Holy shit.
I don't know.
It's fucking my fucking car.
Before we get high
up. Oh, we've just got it.
We
did it. We did it.
Team Luminous. Some of the best speedrunners in Destiny proved themselves on the grandest stage possible. They secured a world's first victory in a time of 5 hours, 29 minutes, and 10 seconds, with second place only 11 minutes behind them, or in terms of this fight, only a run behind them. This race was that close, with third place only being 3 minutes behind second and fourth a minute behind third. Aotera, Clawtivity, Flux, Soto Solace, Shenzi, and Siege Dancers pulled this one together, and with some of their answers, it's amazing how they pulled this one off. According to Aotera, our team hadn't played together in a six ever, along with Flux and Shinzi meeting for the first time. Also, Flux had to leave to infuse Xenophage during the race, since he mistaked Heir Apparent for Xeno. So, yeah, you know, he was ready for the race. The team's main strategy was to gather a ton of special ammo finishers and for them to crack out with it. Claw saved as much ammo as possible while the rest of the team sorted through the mechanics and prepped for damage. They didn't think they had a shot here, with Ethereal and Ascend Team 2 being at the final boss way faster, but they did have the right plan and ended in first place, with Ethereal landing in 19th place. Like I said, the race was that close. Congrats to Luminous on pulling this one off once again. As for my clan, this was our first world's first race as a clan ever, and I could not be more proud of my team coming in 36th and our other team, which was at the boss first, placing 56th. Definitely lots to improve, but this was a victory in my eyes. Now, after the race had been beaten, Luminous unlocked for us one final cutscene.
Sooner or later, we must all face the consequences of our struggle for power. For Eramis, the Deep Stone Crypt provided another grasp at darkness. But firm it was not. Their loss is our gain. For the deepest secrets of Europa are now within our grasp.
CloudStrike was now ready to be grabbed. Eclipse zones from debris raining down after we crashed the station were spread out. The final aspect ready to be picked up, and a whole new area with a familiar voice to the raid was ready to be met.
Who the hell do you think you are?
Excuse me?
The Deep Stone Crypt has stood for centuries without intervention.
Hey! Fuck you, Clovis!
Destroy it all in one fell swoop.
This is the same AI that spoke to us in the crypt and tried to kill us.
This is still early on, and I'm sure there will be even more over time unlocked by the raid, but for now, the Lament Quest was also ready to be started, and from talking to Clovis Bray. Yes, the giant head. That is Clovis Bray's consciousness. The man responsible for the Deepstone Crypt, Exos, Rasputin, Siva, and way, way more has been reduced to this big head now. Well, that is, unless you, you know, knew his actual exo body, which is Banshee 44 in the tower. Yeah, go read it for yourself. Bungie really pulled the Westworld on us. Either way, we need to get back in the raid and talk about some stuff, because while that was day one and it was cool and all, we gotta talk about what most of the players care about the most in Destiny. That feeling of challenge. No. It's the loot. The loot in this raid is absolutely fantastic. This raid has done what I had been hoping a Destiny raid would do for a long time now, and included intrinsic perks that I can only hope stay in the raid. They're not broken good, they're just a bit of a step up from the rest, with reconstruction filling ammo from reserves and thin air, overflow in the magazine to double the mag. Also, recombination, which allows for elemental final blows to do more damage for your kinetic weapons next shot. Combine this with a wide array of weapons and farmable loot, and you have a recipe for the next step for Destiny raids. The gear to me also looks tremendous and fits the theme of what the raid should be about, making all your characters look like futuristic robots. It reminds me of a Destiny 1 raid more than a Destiny 2 raid for these reasons, fully giving meaning and desire to grind the raid to get the best loot possible and look good while you do it. Speaking of loot, the raid exotic, which I was lucky enough to get already, is called Eyes of Tomorrow, and it's like if the Wardcliff Coil, Deathbringer, and Gjallarhorn all had a baby, tracking onto 6 targets separately and blowing them up. With the damage boost too, it can do a ton of damage, making it a must-have as well. So that's basically your loot without getting too far into it, but I want to stress again how much this system makes the raid more valuable. This will be farmed by myself and many others for a long time to come. Now that we've discussed the loot a bit, it's just important we talk about, in layman's terms, what the hell just happened? We went into the Deep Stone Crypt, broke the security system fuses, found that Clovis has been using darkness to make exos, found Atraks bringing Tanix back to life, went to space, prevented Tanix from blowing up Europa by crashing the space station down into Europa, and had one final duel with an old enemy. If that isn't badass, I don't really know what is. I think raids having story significance is also the next step for Destiny, and I hope they continue to go down this route instead of doing the whole it's disconnected from everything else. Hard mode? Hard mode! Nah. Contest, which actually came with a lot of controversy this year, and I will save my thoughts for that on a follow-up video to this one because Reddit went wild on that topic. The short version of my criticism with the raid and difficulty is that it was a fantastic day one experience that I wish stayed difficult, or at least had an option to keep it difficult for extra rewards. I think that this raid nails it in every other category except the difficulty past day one. I think this is the first raid I've played since Wrath of the Machine or Last Wish where I can happily say I enjoyed every single encounter. But this one might be the only one I can say that no encounter is significantly better than the other. They all feel different enough, even though they utilize similar mechanics. The only thing I can hope for is a hard mode in the future and that Bungie shows us more of the actual crypt. I love the space station, but I can only imagine what the Deep Stone Crypt would have fully felt like. Seeing lines of exos being made would have been really cool too. I heard a lot of people also not liking that Tanix was the final boss, and I would have to personally disagree. I think I like seeing a familiar face for once, and I like that the game dropped little teases that he would be the final boss with the cutscene showing him, the lore talking about him, and if you had a good ear for it, you can hear his music from Destiny 1 when you first enter the raid, just slightly. The only thing I could have hoped for with Tanix was that they made him more of an abomination and less of a shank. Like, this dude is crazy enough to punch glass and climb up the ceiling, show him ripping his own mechanical arms off and trying to beat us with them or something, instead of Dr. Eggman flying in on a Walmart scooter. One of the cool things this raid does, which Destiny hasn't done in a while, is allow optional mechanics to speed up the fight for more experienced players. For example, in the first room, you can just walk Scanner through the doors. It's actually a triumph, but it's honestly easier. In the second encounter, just use the lament. Easy. The third encounter you can't really speed up, but the final encounter is awesome because you can break all four of Tanix's pods and dunk all of the balls as long as it's not in the station that Tanix is at, not even requiring you to have Scanner at all. This will start DPS immediately, and Bungie even thought ahead and gave you an extra DPS phase for your thinking on this. So it's amazing. It reminds me a lot of Axis in Wrath of the Machine with supercharged Guardians. I really, really like that. Overall though, this one I think ranks in my top three, right up there with the big boys, Last Wish and Wrath of the Machine. But where does Deep Stone Crypt rank for you among Destiny raids? Let me know in the comments. For the five people still watching to this point in the video, thank you so much for being here, as this was one of, if not the biggest projects I have ever done. This took a lot of community help to put together, and I actually want to thank everyone that sent me clips, whether I got to use them or not, thank you. I am, however, going to be working with Nogi-san again at getting another design. That merch will be going up sometime in the next couple of months, so be on the lookout and make sure you're subscribed to the channel and don't miss a video so that you can check out that merch when it drops. And if you guys want to, of course, I said earlier in the video, you guys can check out my new logo merch. My man Frosty did an amazing job, so if you want to check that out, you can. Finally, if you guys want to talk about this raid, anything in Destiny, anything at all, man, we're playing a ton of games. I'm always on there. You can always come by the Twitch streams at EvanF1997. Anyways, thank you guys so much for watching. Be sure to like and subscribe to the video and enjoy the bloopers, everybody. Thank you. I'm gonna go rest now. Goodbye.
I was a test, so I would make sure the encounters are doing what they're supposed to do, like make sure everything's doing what it's supposed to do. If I had any like concerns, test concerns, I'd make sure those got fixed. Okay. Yeah? That's new. Never saw that one. I tested this, by the way.
This is probably my favorite part.
It's relaxing.
Yeah.
definitely not infuriating at all.
Oh.
Don't be ridiculous.
The longer we get, the more the waste of time is killed.
Oh, that was a good stretch session. Holy shit. Oh, I feel great now. I'm re-energized.
What the
fucking god.
Alright, we got a stasis Andy over here, bro.
Yeah. Oh, god.
What the f is going on?
God, such a freaking
dead dude. It's unreal. Oh my god. What's happening, bro?
Who is doing
this? Dude, well, at least my hot swaps are working on fucking stasis grenades. At least we know that that worked.
What the hell? What? Sprint. Are you sprinting? You definitely are. You. What? Dude, you are. Walk through the snow. Walk through the snow. Up here. Up here. Up here. Up here. Go. This is so cursed.